This is the first light rail on a floating bridge anywhere in the world.
We were trying something for the first time, and we needed to make it work.
It took a lot of grit, and there's a lot of trial and error as you go through a project like this.
When we face these challenges, there's always the temptation to say, hey, oh, we can't do it like that. Well, maybe we can.
The Homer M. Hadley Memorial Bridge stretches more than a mile across Lake Washington, connecting thousands of people every day between Seattle and Eastside communities. Adding light rail on the floating bridge? Now that's a game changer.
I think of each light rail extension as a jewel, because once it opens, the community responds so quickly and so well. My name is Ron Lewis, and from 2012 to 2018, I was executive project director of the East Link project. One thing that was missing was the gem of those jewels, the Crosslake Connection. And that's what this project provides, a high capacity transit link and connection to the East Side.
But long before light rail construction began on the bridge, engineering experts spent years designing innovative solutions for several unique challenges.
There were definitely a lot of challenges. My name's John Slavin. I'm a civil engineer, and I worked on this project for over a decade.
The first challenge was weight limitations on the I-90 floating bridge. Too much weight could cause water intrusion.
We're adding a whole bunch of weight to this bridge. Not only the trains, but we're adding the rails that go onto it, the concrete plinths, the overhead catenary system. But we had to figure out how to mitigate that.
We also had to reimagine the way we typically install rail.
On this bridge, we couldn't drill into those because it had all these cables. And if we snap some of those cables, then you hurt the structural integrity of the bridge.
Plus, running electric trains means the potential for stray current on the bridge.
We need to make sure that that electrical current stayed between the rails and the overhead wire, because if it leaks out, it can cause corrosion.
And then there's movement. The rails needed a certain amount of flexion while also being connected to a fixed point on land.
So really these three different motions means there were six different angles of inflection that those rails would have to accommodate.
After years of research and testing, here's what our engineers designed. Instead of using standard rail, lighter rail saves weight on the bridge. These rails were then set on about 9,000 concrete blocks, which were designed to be lighter and smaller as well.
The concrete plinths that we built, we use what's called lightweight aggregate, right, to keep those plinths, those concrete blocks, as short as possible.
And instead of drilling holes into the bridge surface, we attach the blocks with an extremely strong adhesive.
We use a material called Dex-G, which really glues it on really well.
Then, a plastic drip cap on top of each block further protects the bridge from stray current.
So any water that came down and hit that block would then have to drip, so there wouldn't be a continuous flow of water that would come from the rail onto the bridge deck.
In total, engineers incorporated more than 10 different design elements to protect the bridge from any potential stray current. And of course, there was the monumental challenge of taking a train from solid land onto a floating bridge.
Trains are on a fixed rail. If they're all bent at just one point, they would snap. So we had to take that point displacement and spread it over a longer distance. Think of an uncooked spaghetti. If you bend it at one point, it'll snap. But if you take that whole spaghetti and kind of bend it back and forth, it can do a lot of flexing. And the steel rails are a lot like that. Spread that over a larger distance. And we did that by a system called a track bridge.
There are 8 track bridges. Using existing technology to solve a completely new challenge, the track bridges rely on design components used in retrofitting buildings for earthquakes. Before construction, we put the designs to the test with full-scale models in Pueblo, Colorado.
We had 10,000 sensors on the trains and on the tracks. And at the end of that, it's like, wow, it worked. It's really wonderful.
The team is really everything. And this has been an extraordinary group of people. It's kind of like a relay race. You do your part, and then you're passing it on to the next group so that they can do their part.
Collaboration is key to any large, complex project, but when you're doing a first in the world type of a project, it's absolutely essential. Sometimes in construction, you know, the designer and the contractor and the owner can kind of be in our own corners, but it really shows how when we come together, we can do great things. It is achievable, but the strength of that partnership is so much greater when we work together. Having these great relationships, being transparent, getting to that platform of trust so we can solve these big complex issues. And I think this project is a great example of how we did that.
Once construction is completed, the final stage before opening is meticulous testing.
We're testing everything with increasing levels of complexity to make sure that ultimately we can transport our passengers across the lake on a brand new light rail train. Our team makes sure that the intent is met, making sure that from the different disciplines, the traction power, the train control, the communications, the structures, everything is working individually as it should.
And that every individual component and system works together as a whole. After hundreds of hours of testing, the Crosslake Connection will open in 2026, transforming how we move around the region for generations to come.
My favorite part of the job is seeing at the end of it the people riding the train. The difference that we make into people's lives.
I'm probably luckier than I am smart. And just to have been in the right place at the right time to work with some incredible people. We said, never been done before, let's do it.
How can we use existing infrastructure to continue to expand transit? That's really the key here. And floating bridge is just one piece of that.
I'm very proud, but I'm also humbled by what the art of the possible is when people get together and work together. And when your job is to connect people, we're really creating community and then connecting communities. And to me, that's priceless.